let's tackle why the theoretical yield that we just calculated in the previous part of this lecture, why the theoretical yield is not actually realized in living systems. First of all, this is the theoretical yield for prokaryotes, bacteria for prokaryotes. But the theoretical yield for eukaryotes actually is different. And the reason for that is that let's consider where all this is taking place. If this is the mitochondrion, here's the inner mitochondrial membrane that I'm drawing now. And the matrix of the mitochondrion is here. And the cytoplasm of a eukaryote is here. We know that glycolysis takes place in the cytoplasm. Glycolysis takes place in the cytoplasm. And what do we have that needs to find its way into the matrix from the cytoplasm of glycolysis? We've got two things. We've got NADHs, and those NADHs need to be imported into the matrix of the mitochondrion. And we also have pyruvates that need to be transported into the matrix, because pyruvate oxidation occurs in the mitochondrial matrix. So we have to expend energy doing this. And for every NAD imported, we have to utilize an ATP. We have to expend the energy of ATP dephosphorylation to produce ADP plus PI in order to get an NADH in there. And since we have two NADHs from glycolysis, we need to bring two NADHs in. We are spending two ATP. So the theoretical yield in eukaryotes, unlike prokaryotes, which is 38 ATP, in eukaryotes, we have a theoretical yield of 36 ATP. Our net yield is 36, not 38, because we have to expend two ATPs getting this in. In addition, bringing pyruvate into the mitochondrion costs energy as well. And so we have to consider the limits to theoretical yields because, number one, the inner mitochondrial membrane is not completely impermeable to hydrogen ions. There's some leakiness that occurs. You have a leaky membrane. So not all the hydrogen ions are able to flow through the ATP synthase and yield ATP. Also, we need to get pyruvate in here, and pyruvate entry into the inner mitochondrial membrane, let's draw it over here, pyruvate entering goes through a symporter. And you'll remember what a symporter is. A symporter is a molecule that translocates, uses the energy of diffusion to translocate one molecule, in this case, hydrogen ions, and it uses the energy of an ion flowing down a concentration gradient to co-translocate another molecule. In this case, that is pyruvate. So pyruvate gets into the matrix of the mitochondrion by virtue of being transported by a symporter integral membrane protein that uses hydrogen ions to provide energy for that importation of pyruvate. And so not all hydrogen ions then are going through the ATP synthase molecule. They are, in fact, first of all, the membrane is leaky, and we need to have hydrogen ions that are co-translocated with pyruvate. So we lose some hydrogen ions that way. So the theoretical yield for eukaryotes is not the actual yield. What we actually have is approximately 30 ATP per molecule of glucose oxidized in this process. So our actual yield is less than our theoretical yield. So then this is an overview of what we've been going over for the past little bit. We've done glycolysis, pyruvate oxidation, Krebs cycle, electron transport chain, and then oxidative phosphorylation using ATP synthase. And the only thing we have to do to modify this figure really is to put in four hydrogen ions pumped per complex so that an NADH would yield 12 pumped hydrogens and an FADH2 would yield 8 pumped hydrogens. So here's our overview, and now we can talk about our theoretical energy yields. 38 for bacteria, as we've talked about, 36 for eukaryotes, and the actual energy yield, as I've said, is about 30 ATP per glucose for eukaryotes. And the reduced yield is due to that leaky inner membrane of the mitochondrion, and also the use of the proton gradient for purposes other than ATP synthesis, which I've told you, and I've told you one use is to import pyruvate with a symporter. So that accounts for a reduced actual yield. And here is our theoretical yield calculated. You can review this on your own. It's in a nice, neat form, and we can review that these are the NAD, the electron carriers that enter, that allow for chemiosmosis synthesis of ATP, whereas we have substrate level phosphorylation at the Krebs cycle and in glycolysis. Now, the respiratory pathway is a biochemical pathway that can be regulated. And we've talked about the theoretical nature of feedback inhibition, but we haven't given a specific example. So we can give specific examples, namely inhibiting a step of glycolysis by high levels of ATP, and NADH inhibiting pyruvate dehydrogenase, and as well high levels of ATP inhibiting citrate synthetase. So let's look at this schematically here now. Phosphofructokinase, as we've mentioned, is a key regulatory point in the glycolytic pathway. And it makes sense that ADP, adenosine diphosphate, would activate allosterically this enzyme. Because if you have lots of ADP around, that means that you're probably deficient in the amount of ATP you have. That is, the relative levels of ADP and ATP have been shifted to ADP. So we want to make more ATP in that case, in which case ADP binds to an allosteric site on the phosphofructokinase enzyme and activates it so that we proceed with glycolysis very rapidly. On the other hand, lots of ATP bind allosterically to phosphofructokinase and inhibit it, which makes sense. If you have lots of Volkswagens coming off the factory floor and not many people buying them, that means you have lots of product around. And so you don't want to spend time and energy wasting energy on running your factory floor. That would be the case here as well. ATP, if we have lots of ATP, we want to inhibit the manufacture of more ATP. So we inhibit glycolysis fairly early in the glycolytic pathway. Now, NADH inhibits, high levels of NADH inhibits pyruvate dehydrogenase. High levels of NADH are saying, we don't need to make more acetyl-CoA here and run them through the Krebs cycle because we've got plenty of NADH being manufactured by the Krebs cycle already. So if you've got lots of it around, you can not waste any more energy running the Krebs cycle anymore by inhibiting pyruvate oxidation, by inhibiting pyruvate dehydrogenase. And so you can see then that the products of the pathway in terms of energetic products act as negative feedback points for allosteric inhibition of key enzymes in the pathways that we've been discussing. And with the exception that ADP activates phosphofructokinase for reasons we've already discussed. Now, let's move on now and talk about oxidation that occurs without oxygen. Now, it sounds oxymoronic. How can you have oxidation without oxygen? Remember, oxidation is simply the loss of electrons. So we can have a loss of electrons. We can rearrange the chemical bonds of food molecules without using O2 as the final electron acceptor. We can have anaerobic respiration in which inorganic molecules other than oxygen serve as a final electron acceptor. That would be called anaerobic respiration. Aerobic would imply oxygen, anaerobic without oxygen. Or two, we can have fermentation in which organic molecules act as the final electron acceptor in a pathway. So if we look at anaerobic respiration by methanogens, they use CO2 as a final electron acceptor. They reduce CO2 and they reduce that to methane, CH4. So these are the methanogens. They generate methane. and they use CO2, not oxygen, as the final electron acceptor. Anaerobic respiration by sulfur bacteria uses a sulfate as the final electron acceptor, and that is reduced to hydrogen sulfide. So sulfur bacteria produce hydrogen sulfide. And there's evidence for the early evolution of sulfur bacteria using sulfate as the final electron acceptor in anaerobic respiration by these bacteria. There's fossil evidence that shows about 2 billion, billion years ago, there's evidence that sulfur bacteria were using this process because of the ratios of isotopes of sulfur found in fossil deposits. Now, fermentation is another example of oxidation without oxygen. So let's take lactic acid fermentation first. When you work out and your muscles are working out hard and you can't deliver enough oxygen to your muscles, they go anaerobic. And they don't have enough oxygen to run respiration. So at the end of glycolysis, they take the pyruvate that is produced by glycolysis and they use that to reduce pyruvate to lactic acid. And when you have sore muscles, that's because of anaerobic fermentation that's occurring in your muscles, and the lactic acid causes your muscle cells to be sore. And so in that case, NADH is used to reduce pyruvate to lactic acid and regenerating NAD+, which can be used for more glycolysis. And then yeasts conduct ethanol fermentation in the absence of oxygen. So that's how we make wine and beer and spirits. We ferment pyruvate to CO2, ethanol, and NAD+ are produced. So we reduce pyruvate to ethanol. We produce a CO2 molecule for every pyruvate molecule that is reduced, and we regenerate NAD+ for more glycolysis. And here is a summary of those steps: alcohol fermentation in yeast and lactic acid fermentation in muscle. And you can study this on your own. I've just gone over it verbally, but you can follow the diagram. All right, now we're ready to tackle catabolism, but not catabolism of carbohydrates, but catabolism of proteins and fat. And they feed into biosynthetic pathway, they feed into catabolic pathways as well. So let's look at that in the next section of this lecture.